Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this event. I know we have some who are still looking for places to sit. We have plenty of seats, so I'll give you time to do that. It's always a pleasure to have a great number of folks out for such a tremendous event. And I want to also recognize your hardiness that you came out on a very cold January night. Oh, pardon me, it's just November. I think the almanac may be correct, and a certain weatherman on a certain channel may be wrong that this is going to be a mild winter if we start this way. I believe that you're going to be rewarded for your attendance tonight. This is going to be a great presentation. We've seen, or you've heard parts of it, and now we're going to continue with that. As you came in, you were handed a program and a card. I want to ask you to realize that that card is for you to use in asking questions of Mark Lanier. Please feel free to write your questions on that card, and we will collect those at the beginning of our question and answer session following his presentation. I know why you're here, and so let's get on with this. It's my pleasure to introduce the president of Lubbock Christian University. Lubbock Christian University is truly blessed to have serving as our president a leader who grew up about a block from the campus the way the crow flies. He was the son of two of our most beloved teachers, his father a historian, his mother an English/librarian. That gives you some idea of his lineage and his heritage. He is a graduate of Lubbock Christian University, a professional who proved himself as an attorney, as an educator, and who now has come back to lead our university. It's my pleasure to present President Perrin.
Thank you, Don. It's so great to be with you tonight. Welcome to Lubbock Christian University to this very special occasion. We're so thrilled that you've chosen to join us. It's gonna be fun. Hope you're ready for a very stimulating and provocative evening here as we talk about Mark's new book. I wanna say a word of appreciation to Greg Garrett and Platinum Bank for their partnership with us tonight and for their sponsoring our event. Can we show our appreciation to Platinum Bank? It's a great thrill to introduce Mark Lanier, a man that is very difficult to introduce because he's done so much and there's so much one could say about him. But most importantly for us tonight, we want to acknowledge that he is from Lubbock, Texas. Mark Lanier is a product of Lubbock. We give thanks for that. He has gone from this place and done great things, but started out at Coronado High School, and after a brief sojourn to Tennessee for college, where he graduated from David Lipscomb University with a degree in biblical languages, Mark came back to Texas Tech University School of Law, where he was the stuff of legend. I came into law school at Tech right as Mark graduated, and people were talking about his exploits. He was a great student advocate and did well in competitions. It was a foreshadowing of some of the success that Mark would have as a trial lawyer. He went on to Fulbright and Jaworski initially in Houston, Texas, and then ultimately set up his own firm, the Lanier Law Firm, which is surely one of the foremost law firms in America, and Mark's often identified as perhaps the best trial lawyer in America today. Some of his verdicts are remarkable, including a recent verdict in the amount of $9 billion. That's a lot of money, and Mark hasn't collected it yet, but there's a certain kind of satisfaction that comes just in getting a verdict of that size. Mark is very, very capable in the courtroom. But what I love about Mark is not just his excellence as a trial lawyer, but the kind of person he is, the way, things he values, the kind of life he leads. He's a person of deep faith, and it's manifested in so many ways. Mark founded the Lanier Theological Library in Houston, which is a wonderful resource for students of the Bible, those interested in theological studies. Mark teaches a Bible class at his home church in Houston that has north of 750 attendees on a typical Sunday morning, where he goes through the Bible, teaching biblical literacy. In fact, this book was born out of that Bible class. Mark's a person of deep faith who believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. It's a powerful testimony from a powerful individual. And his book that we're going to hear about tonight, Christianity on Trial, A Lawyer Examines the Christian Faith. Won't you join me in welcoming Mr. Mark Lanier.
Thank you, my friend. Come on, buddy. I got to tell you, when I was in high school, one of the first chances I got to speak publicly to a group of any size at all was right in this very auditorium where John King, who's still with Lubbock Christian, had asked me to speak on one of their youth nights here. And it was during a summer camp called Encounter. So it brought back a flood of memories for me to get to come back here. I think I should have my PowerPoint up, if we can get my PowerPoint up, Nate. And he's going to bring it up in just a moment, I suspect. Maybe he thinks if I hit this button, it will come up automatically. Maybe it does. There we go. Okay, so here's the background behind this, what we're talking about. Now that I see where we are. The background behind this is I was speaking at a seminar in Scottsdale, Arizona. And it had been a long day. I'd been at a hearing in Orange County, California, earlier that day. I had flown back. It was just really tough. I had to give two speeches the next day. I was totally wiped out. And I had to do this dinner event. And so I did the dinner event. And you may be shocked by this, but in the world at large, not every lawyer is a Christian. And so I found myself with a bunch of my compatriots of the bar, and they were very nice. I mean, I like these people. They're my friends, but some of them I didn't know well. And so after the dinner, I was trying to sneak out, for lack of a better way of saying it, and get to my room so that I could do a couple of things, including write the introduction to this book that was due at the publisher's. So I'm kind of saying, good to see you, good to see you, good to see you, as I try to make my way back to the hotel room. And in the process of that, a fellow from Seattle named Vic says to me, hey, I looked you up on your website. And I said, cool. And I'm, you know, a lot of people will Google my name, and they're lawyers, and they want to see, you always want to see what other lawyers are saying about themselves and all. And he said, I said, you know, I don't run the law firm website, but, and I hadn't looked at it in a while, but I'm sure it's got the information you'd want. Oh, no, I don't mean that. He said, when I Googled your name, you got Christian websites. And I said, yeah, I'm a Christian. He says, really? You like believe there's a God? And I said, yeah, absolutely. He says, well, I sure would like to hear how you'd ever present that to a judge without being thrown out of court. If you're a lawyer, he said in legalese, I'd like to hear your Daubert hearing on that. But that's what it means if I translate it into everyday talk. All right? So I was kind of tired and sneaking out until he said that, but somewhere that invigorates two different parts of my soul. It invigorates the part of my soul that loves to talk about the Lord, and it invigorates the part of my soul that loves to take up my sword when people think that I'm an idiot for believing in the Lord. So I said to Vic, I said, hey, I'd talk to you about it right now if you want. He said, let's do it. So I pulled the chair around. And as I was sitting down and he had pulled a chair around, about seven other lawyers had overheard this. And they all pulled their chairs around. They said, we want in. We want in. We want in. So I was sitting there. I had Vic, who was an atheist, or an agnostic. Different. Atheist, no God. Agnostic, So I got Vic, the okay, but a pretty strident And then I've got next to him two atheists. And then as you go around, I got a lady who was kind of a new ager. And she was in trip. And then We had one person who kind of claimed a Christian faith, I think, but kind of claimed a number of different faiths, depending upon what point of the conversation it was. And then we had a couple of people with Jewish heritage who were non-believers in God, but had a Jewish heritage behind them and came up in homes that had taught a Jewish faith. And then there's me. And so Mike, who's sitting to my right, says to me, "I'm an atheist." And I said, "I know you are, Mike. We've had this discussion before." Mike had been to a different part of the bar earlier, not the legal part. And I said, "I know, Mike." And he says, "But I'm a golden rule atheist." I said, "You're a what?" "I'm a golden rule atheist. It comes from the golden rule, where Jesus said to do unto others as you would have others do unto you." I said, I know the golden rule, Mike. And I said, "But what do you mean you're a golden rule atheist?" He says, "Well, I believe in the golden rule, and I try to live by it, even though I don't think there's a God." I looked at him, I said, "Why on earth would you do something that stupid?" He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "If you don't believe there's a God, why are you living by the golden rule? Man, that's a dog-eat-dog world. You need to be looking out for you and yours. Number one." He says, "Well, that's not very noble." And I said, "What does noble mean? There's no God. You got no basis to call anything noble. We're just a bunch of atoms. What gives you significance and meaning?" He said, "Well, we're atoms that think." I said, "So?" And he says, "You don't think we have meaning?" I said, "Oh, I do. I'm a Christian. I believe that we're made in the image of God and we have value because God made us. I think there is nobility. I think there are values. And I think people are valuable. But I said, if you take God out of the equation, nah, I don't believe any of that." And he says, "Well, I just think the world operates better on the golden rule." And I said to him, I said, "Have you been fishing lately?" He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Do you really think the world operates on the golden rule? How many sharks have you seen who treat other fish the way they'd like to be treated?" He said, "Well, I hadn't really thought of that." I said, "Well, let's expand it beyond sharks. How many animals, fish in the sea, period, treat all the other little fishies the way they'd like to be treated? They eat each other all the time. The way of the world is to eat." I said, "By the way, did you have a steak for dinner?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Why were you eating your cousin?" "What do you mean?" I said, "Why aren't you a vegan, at least, a vegetarian?" He said, well, "I like steak." I said, "Well, why are you, you don't think cows think? You don't think they think, I'd like to eat the grass. Munch, munch, munch. They got a brain. They may not think consciously the way we do." He said, "Well, I hadn't really thought of that." I said, "You got a grandmother? She died last year." I said, "Did y'all eat her?" He said, "What?" I said, "You're a golden rule atheist. Why not eat grandma when she died?" "Well, we would never do that." "Why?" "Well, that would dishonor her." "Dishonor her. Why, Mr. Golden Rule Atheist? After all, an excellent source of protein and calcium." Well, you don't eat people." I said, "There are people starving in India. They need the protein and calcium. Did you throw away good food?" Well, "She's not just food, she's a human." I said, "Okay." I said, "Now here's where we start our discussion. Because my good golden rule atheist recognizes what we all do. There is something valuable in a human being. There's something inherently valuable, noble even. Something that says humans should be treated differently than all other species, and something that says humans should treat each other differently than we expect other species to treat themselves. Now, my question is, why is that the belief system that is hardwired into our brain and into the core of our being? Why do we believe these people have this value? I think it's a reflection of the fact that God made us in His image. And so we bear this stamp from God that recognizes human beings have unique value. It makes sense to me that whether you believe in God or not, you still are hardwired to think that God has this, that humans have this value because God stamped it in who you are. You just may not realize where it came from. I said, so what this book is an intersection. It's an intersection between my profession as a lawyer and my faith. And I take the tools as a lawyer and try to examine my faith to see if it's rational, to see if I can prove it. Not just the existence of God, but if God exists, what kind of God is he, she, or it? And what are the implications for you and me? And do we really make choices? And what's reality? And is there morality? And is there a basis for thinking God might actually produce something we could call scripture? Is the audacity of the resurrection of Jesus something that we can academically, rationally, logically say that makes sense to me? So at this intersection between faith and profession, I write this book to examine these things as a lawyer. And in the process of examining them as a lawyer, asking the question, does life support? And by life, I mean the way we live, the way we think, the way we function, the values we hold, the way we're wired internally. What we know to be true and know to be right. Does it support the fundamentals of the Christian faith? Is belief a rational choice? Those are my questions. And I examine the human life, and I examine our thoughts and our history with the question of how do we fit the puzzle piece into our view of the world? Here's what I'm driving at. I have a view of the world. I think God is responsible for this world. I think God made you and me. I'm not getting into the fuss over evolution and creation and all the rest of that. I don't want to get into that fuss right now. And they tried to divert me into that fuss. I said, no, put that fuss aside. God made me. He made me, period. I'm from my mom and dad, yes. But God still made me. You know, my wife made me tea in the morning. Or you could say the tea was made in the morning by the heat of the gas exciting the electrons and the molecules and causing agitation such that the water got hot, such that when it was poured over the leaves of the mint plant, they exuded oils and aromas and fragrances and polluted the water into turning it into tea. Both valid ways of saying. So I don't want to get into that fight. Here's what I want to tell you. I believe that there is a God who is moral, who is real, who is personal, who in the midst of all of creation made humanity and made us special in His image such that we are also personal, we are also moral, we are creatures who can love, we are creatures who can make choices, we are creatures who can live a rational, thoughtful, creative existence. And that's the way God made us. And yet, in the midst of that, we made choices that caused us to turn from God and become, in a sense, broken. And we live in a world that reflects that brokenness. So there's this urge within all of us, this recognition that there's got to be more to life. There's got to be some meaning behind the word justice. There's got to be a meaning behind the word good. There's got to be something better. There's got to be purpose. There's got to be meaning. And all of us have that voice within us. We may try to stamp it out and snuff its existence gone. We may try to stranglehold it, but it's there. And I believe it's there. And I've got to explain why it's there. And I've got to try and figure out what view of the world fits this reality that I know is true. What makes the most sense of things? How do I best understand this drive within me for wanting to do things that are good and yet not being able to do them as well as I would like? For wanting to avoid things that are bad and yet finding myself drifting over there? And I think the Christian view of God and the Christian view of the world is what makes the most sense of things. So the chapter of the book that I'll talk to you about tonight is a chapter on evil, on right and wrong. And I've yet to meet anybody that doesn't recognize that the horrors and atrocities of the Third Reich were without question wrong. Not just morally bankrupt, but morally evil. And I do believe that most everybody recognizes that. And you can go and you can look and you can see the pictures. You can read the testimony from the Nuremberg trials when Hitler's henchmen were put on trial. And all of this evil that they did was laid open for the world to see. Now I put in the slide a trial picture. You've got Hermann Göring. You've got Rudolf Hess, von Ribbentrop, you've got Keitel, you've got these guys who were put for trial. And sometime when you're really bored, read the Nuremberg transcripts. You'll find it chilling. You'll find testimony from people like you read the Columbia Daily Spectator. I tried to pull some old newspaper accounts. Otto Ohlendorf, a chief central security officer, said the Einstadt unit would enter a village or town and order the prominent, I hope you can see it, Jewish citizens to call together all Jews for the purpose of resettlement. They were requested to hand over their valuables and shortly before execution to surrender their outer clothing. They were transported to the place of executions, usually an anti-tank ditch, in trucks, always only as many as could be executed immediately. In this way, it was attempted to keep the span of time from the moment in which the victims knew what was about to happen to them until the time of their actual execution as short as possible. Then they were shot, kneeling or standing by firing squads in a military manner, and the corpses were thrown into a ditch. Read the testimony, not just of Otto Ohlendorf, but read what Hermann Greibe had to say. He was a German engineer who in October of 1942, in charge of a manufacturing plant, was going to find some Jewish workers that had accidentally been shipped off. And he goes behind a mound and he sees a family. And the family's required to take off their clothes and put their shoes in one pile, put their outer clothing in another, their underclothing in another, stand naked together in front of a tank ditch, while the grandmother's holding a one-year-old baby who's cooing, the father is pointing at the sky for his seven-year-old son who's crying. The mother is crying. One of the daughters walks by Hermann and points to herself and says, 23, so he would know her age. And then naked, they stand before a German soldier with a machine gun, machine guns them all down in such a way that they fall into the ditch on top of innumerable bodies, some of which are still writhing in the last throes of life. Herman testified that the shoes there, based on his estimation, told him that there were somewhere between 800 or 1,000 in the ditch, already dead. And this is outrageous. This is indefensible. This is wrong. We all agree this is wrong. I've yet to find anybody whose core says, well, you know, they were having a bad day. No, this is morally repugnant. This is beyond thinking. The pictures tell the same story. It's absolutely indefensible. Yet, here's the question. Why? This is the question I ask my non-believing friends. If there is no God, why what Hitler did and his henchmen did, why was it wrong? Your body tells you it's wrong. So my question is simply one of academia. Academically, mentally, rationally, logically, you tell me why it is wrong. Now, they'll come up with answers. But I think those answers fall short, and I'll explain why. And I'd like to start by telling you, if I were ordered by a judge to defend Hitler or his henchmen in court, how would I do it? Hitler, of course, didn't make it to court. He suicided in a bunker. But if I had been ordered, how would I do it? Let me tell you what I'd do. First thing I'd do is jury selection. I don't want anybody who believes in God on my jury. Because if you believe in God, I got no way to defend the actions of Hitler. It clearly violated God's morality, God's standards. It's wrong. Anybody who believes in God is going to say Hitler was wrong. It's abhorrent. I lose. So I want people who don't believe in God. No God. And then I want to make this argument. Are you ready? Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, in 1859, Charles Darwin published On the Origin of the Species. Charles Darwin had finally looked through the telescope of history and determined that humanity were really just descendants from some common ancestor with the apes. And before that, had descended from other animals, from other animals, from other animals, ultimately from a singular life form or a multiple life form of a single cell or whatever you chase it back to. Some protein amalgamation of amino acids zapped into existence through lightning. Now, after that, in 1881, a friend and a protege of sorts, or a compatriot, maybe we should say, of Darwin, Herbert Spencer, a British biologist, wrote the first real textbook on biology. And Herbert Spencer's famous because he coined a phrase in that book, survival of the fittest. And here's what he was saying. He was saying, look, first of all, survival of the fittest does not mean strongest survives. Survival of the fittest means the creature most fit for the environment in which that creature finds itself will survive and thrive in that environment while those less fit will not. Less fit for the environment. So Herbert Spencer coins this phrase. And then let's jump across the English Channel, blip through France real fast, and go to Germany. And in the end of the 1800s and into the early 1900s, read the writings of Friedrich Nietzsche. Son of a Lutheran minister. Nietzsche lost his faith, decided there was no God. And Darwin looked through the telescope at the history of humanity. Nietzsche turned around and looked into the future of humanity. And Nietzsche said that, yes, we used to be apes, now we're humans. But there's going to come a time in the evolutionary process where we become superhumans, the Übermensch, the overman. There's going to come a time where who we are, we look back historically on the humanity of the 20th century or 19th century, the same way humanity in that time period looked back on the apes. Hitler was a big fan of Nietzsche. And thus spoke Zarathustra. Nietzsche says, the human being must become better and more evil. To improve, to genetically change, to become the Superman, to be a better human, we've got to break free of the shackles of what people consider evil. And so this is what Hitler reads. Here's a picture of Hitler visiting Nietzsche's sister who ran the Nietzsche archives after Nietzsche's death. Hitler's a big fan. So now you put all of this together and you come up and you ask this question: how do you defend Hitler? Here's my argument, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. Remember, you don't believe in God. Get on my jury. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, humanity is a fascinating blip on the screen of history. Relatively new blip, relatively recent. And while the religious crowd like to think that there's something special about humanity, we recognize that we're only one in a chain of animals. And we're not even the end of the chain. We're a link. And that chain goes to a magnificent future. But to get to that future, we need to do some things. We need to propel ourselves. We need to purify our genetic base. We need to figure out how to conquer some of the diseases and the problems. Look, we have Ebola scares. And we have no qualms about using monkeys to do medical experimentation on if it's going to help save humanity from an Ebola outbreak. In the same way, we should not hesitate to use the genetically inferior that are going to keep us from becoming the super race we should become. If we need to medically experiment on them, let Mendela do his thing. Because our goal is to, you know, Hitler is purifying. He's making us better. We're becoming the superhumans. And, lest any of you forget, what Hitler did was legal in Germany. He wasn't breaking the law. Hitler was elected by the people. The German government passed the laws. Hitler did it all legally. Now that defense doesn't work to people who believe in God. The immorality has to be explained, though. And so at Nuremberg, at the Nuremberg trials, there were four prosecutors to try and indict Hitler's henchmen. One from the U.S., Justice Robert Jackson, who took a 2-year leave of absence from the U.S. Supreme Court. Trivia note, last U.S. Supreme Court justice to serve who'd never finished law school. Really smart guy, though. All right, we got Justice Robert Jackson there. The Brits have their prosecutor. The French have a prosecutor. The Soviets have a prosecutor. The four prosecutors meet in London. They say, all right, we got to get this program together. We got to figure out what crimes we're going to indict them under. Then we've got to figure out how they get lawyers. We've got to figure out how the trial is going to be held. They get to cross-examine the witnesses. We got to figure all this stuff out, try to get neutrals as judges. The Russian, or the Soviet, says, what? This is stupid. We do this in our country all the time. They don't need lawyers. We don't need to charge. He says, here, let me tell you how to do this. You bring them in. You say, how do you plead? If they say, guilty, you take them out and you shoot them. If they say, not guilty, you look them in the eye. You say, the court finds you guilty. You take them out and you shoot them. It takes 5 minutes apiece. The Frenchman agreed with the Soviet guy. France had been invaded after all. The American and the Brit say, no. History's going to judge us. We have to do this right. We have to indict them under laws. We have to show that what they did was criminal. And then Robert Jackson and the Brits have a big problem. It wasn't criminal. So they go through these legal gymnastics of trying to figure out, maybe in 1929 when the Nazi articles and positions were being drawn up, they conspired with the future Nazis to do things that were illegal in 1929. Legal gymnastics. But you read the opening statement of Justice Robert Jackson, and he talks about things like inalienable rights. Well, what is an inalienable right? It makes sense to someone who believes in God. It's a right God gave us. And every human's got it. But if you don't believe in God, there's no such thing as an inalienable right. I mean, it's a right given by society. It's a right given by 51%. It's a right given by the powerful. It's a right given by this sense of feeling. What makes that inalienable? If society changes, or the 51% change, or the sense and the feeling changes. Then he talks about evil. We saw what Nietzsche already just did to that word. Then he talks about the inhuman conduct. What is inhuman conduct? Barking like a dog, I guess. That's inhuman. Yeah, that's canine. I mean, what does that mean? To someone who believes in God, inhuman conduct means something. So it's a fascinating thing. But you ask this question of how do we decide that what Hitler did was immoral? How do we decide it was wrong? How do we decide what right and wrong are? And there are some common answers. One is, well, it's whatever works to assist society, whatever makes society better. Okay, define whose society you're talking about. Germany had their own society. Sharks in the ocean have their own society. There's a pod of dolphins. I mean, what if society changes their mind? There's an Islamic state over in the Middle East that's decided that to assist society is to put in Islam law. And that's the best way to assist society. And we say, no, they're wrong. Why? Well, the Christian and I dare say that the Bible-believing Jew has a basis for saying why they're wrong, the Judeo-Christian ethic. But if there's no God, everything in your being might say, well, that's wrong. That's what works to assist society in their book. So I don't think that right and wrong can be decided by that. Well, what about what works to assist an individual? If it makes me happy, that might mean I can steal from you. Now, I've got to do it without getting caught. It would be wrong if I got caught, because then it would not assist me. I would go to jail. But as long as I don't get caught, stealing from you assists me. And yet we know that's not right. Could Hitler's men have defended themselves by saying, hey, this assisted me? So it was right. No. What's another option? Well, it's what certain people think. So we just have certain people that get to be the value police. And they get to decide right and wrong for all the rest of us, and we just have to live by their standards. You know, Germany doesn't get to decide right and wrong for itself in the 1930s and 40s. America gets to decide it for them. Maybe it's not what certain people think. Maybe instead it just simply exists like math. We're real proud of our son. He's just absolutely, as someone said, smarter than a tree full of owls. Ivy League education in philosophy, goes, gets his grad degrees in philosophy, master's, PhD from Oxford, teaches at Oxford Logic and Philosophy for a couple of years. Now he's at Hebrew University. Really smart, smart young man. Runs around with a lot of smart people. And one of his buds, who's a PhD in ethics, ethical philosophy, from Oxford, and I've been having an ongoing dialogue for several years now. And he is of the position that good simply exists in the universe. It's inherent in the fabric of the universe, just like math is. 2 + 2 = 4, he says, whether there's a God or not. In like way, wrongful killing, the actions of Hitler were wrong, whether there's a God or not. It's just part of the fabric of the universe. And I say to him, when? When did it become part of the fabric of the universe? Because it's not the fabric of the universe in the ocean with the fish. It's not the fabric of the universe with the wolves. If you watch all those Alaska shows right now, it's not the fabric of the universe with bears. Well, it's the fabric of the universe on right and wrong for humans. When? Apes kill apes. They're very territorial. When did it become? And that's a real problem with this perspective. But I will tell you that I've told them, actually, now that I've argued against it, let me tell you, I sort of agree with you. But I believe it's in the fabric of the universe because that's the way God made it. And what you're sensing as the fabric of the universe is actually an evidence that there is a creator God who has a morality and put it into the fabric of the universe. It's stamped in our soul. It explains why all of us think it's wrong, whether we can explain it adequately or not. We know viscerally it is. Now, I'm not satisfied with it simply exists if you leave it there. Now, a lot of Christians, when you ask them this, they'll say it's whatever God commanded. But that's a trick that leads you to a marvelous piece. Okay, I have to check the time. We don't have a clock in here. I was supposed to be done, and I'm not done. So y'all are losing your Q&A time a little bit. Okay, sorry. Give me 10 minutes. I'll try and wrap this up. But there is, in philosophy, if you read philosophy, you'll read something called Euthyphro's Dilemma. Euthyphro's Dilemma rolls right off the tongue. Euthyphro's Dilemma is written up by Plato. And it's a dialogue that Socrates has with this young fella named Euthyphro. And that's actually not a painting of Socrates and Euthyphro, but it looks really like it could be. So I'm using it. Socrates is an old man in Athens who's being taken to trial for corrupting the youth of Athens. Ultimately, he gets found guilty and is killed for it, capital punishment. Walking to court, Socrates comes across the path of Euthyphro, a young man. Now, Socrates is being indicted and will be killed for corrupting the young men. But Euthyphro, who he finds, is a young man who's going to court planning to corrupt the old people. He's trying to get his dad killed for something his dad did. And in the dialogue that Socrates has with Euthyphro, Socrates is trying to uncorrupt the young man. It's Plato's way of paying homage to his teacher, Socrates. One way. So Socrates is trying to restore. And he begins to challenge the young man. Say, what did your dad do that was so wrong? And the man says. And Socrates says, now why do you say it's wrong? And Euthyphro says, well, because the gods say it's wrong. And Socrates says, which gods? Because, you know, they're a fickle lot. And they can change their mind and they don't always agree amongst themselves. And he says, you're right. He says, well, it's the powerful gods. And Socrates says, what makes you think the powerful gods are more right than the less powerful gods? And Socrates proceeds to walk through the exact moral dilemma that I just gave you before, except he does it through the idea of the gods. And finally, Euthyphro says, well, look, it's whatever the most of the gods are doing. That's good. Socrates says the following. Here's his point. Is God good because he does good? Do we say, oh, God is good because God's doing these good things? If so, good is more powerful than God. It trumps God. God just happens to be naturally gifted and talented at doing these things good. But good is a greater thing than God. Or, the dilemma is here, if that's not true, then good must be whatever God says. In which event, good is now arbitrary again. It's just set up by some really powerful guy. And that's the dilemma. And philosophers still write about it and still talk about it. The problem is, neither Socrates nor Euthyphro nor many philosophers since have the Judeo-Christian God to answer that question, or they'd answer it differently. Now, we've got some young people in here. Raise your hand if you're young. Put your hand down, Kevin. You might be thinking, hey, who reads Plato? Who reads about Socrates and Euthyphro? I got an answer. Kanye West and Jay-Z. I don't know when the last time was they were played in this auditorium. See if you know this song.
Human beings in a mind. What's a mind to a king? What's a king to a god? What's a god to a non-believer?
And that's the question. They read Euthyphro's dilemma. Is pious pious? Is good good because God loves good? He's just really good at it? Is it because of what he says? Socrates wants to know which side you're on. I got an answer, Kanye. Here's my answer. Here's the biblical answer. Here's the answer that fits the puzzle of how we think and feel and act the best. Good reflects God's character. God is a moral being. God has morality. God is honest. He does not lie. God is just. He is not unjust. God is love. God is truth. There is a moral character and fiber to God's essence, the unchanging God, who then made us in his image. So that same moral character and fiber and sense of good is imprinted in our essence. It's hardwired into our being. And when we say good, in its ultimate meaning, we're meaning God-like. Not because God's able to do good things and there's a good outside of God. Good is the definition of God's character. That's the word we use to describe God's morality. So it's not what God just fickle says, nor is it a standard that God lives up to, Euthyphro's dilemma. It is God. It's his character. So now, oops, get that back. There we go. Is it whatever God commanded that's right and wrong? No, no, no. Our source for understanding good and evil as people of the Judeo-Christian faith is, it's whatever God's character is. That's what we need to be looking at. That's why we try to understand him. That's a blessing of God's incarnation in Jesus. We see the character of God living in a broken, polluted world. And that's what we're trying to follow. So, how do we explain the immorality of Hitler? It was wrong because it was ungodly. It was inhuman. It was evil. We can use those words from a Judeo-Christian basis. And the fact that we all know it's wrong and it begs for an explanation, I can't find any piece of the puzzle that best explains that gut visceral reaction we have than that of a God who is a moral, real God who's made us in his image such that we can relate to these things. Does life support the fundamentals? I love that S there. Fundamentals of the Christian faith? Is belief a rational choice? Well, I'd go through lots of other ideas and points in the book, but this is the chapter on how morality and right and wrong at least give a resounding yes to those questions. And so from that perspective, Christianity on trial is the way that I see it. You guys have been kind. I get to meet you guys, I hope, when we're out there signing some books. But meanwhile, I think I left myself some time for questions. I only went 7 minutes, 8 minutes over. Thank you.
It's all your time, so there's no wrong time for your remarks to be done. Thank you, Mark. That was excellent. Appreciate. So glad that you're here tonight. I want to go back to the, and let me say, if you have questions, if you've written them down on the card, or if you want to write them down on the card, now's a good time to do so. Pass them to the end of the aisle. There are going to be some folks coming down, and I hope you have some good, hard questions for Mark. I know he's looking forward to your best shots. I thought we might go back to something you said at the beginning tonight. So often today, the conversations with what's sometimes called the new atheist, Richard Dawkins and others, sets up a really sharp conflict between faith and science. And you in your book, I think it's page 84, you give a definition of that science talks about the how and theology talks about the why. I thought you might share about that with us.
Yeah, it's, there we go. It's, to me, it's like the tea kettle explanation that I referenced briefly. For a long time in history, see, as God's creatures, we know there's more. And we know there's reason behind the universe. We know there's rationality. We'll call it cause and effect. And because we know about cause and effect, there are events that primitive people did not and do not understand. Thunder. Lightning. The sun starting out over there and going over there. And so primitive people find these gaps of knowledge where they don't understand cause and effect. And yet they know there's got to be one. And so historically, what a lot of primitive people have done is assign it to God. The Egyptians would tell you that the sun is a chariot of fire being driven across the sky. That thunder to the Mesopotamians was Baal, who's riding forth on his chariots. The Norse would tell you that Thor was the thunder god. And people would assign to God the cause when they saw the effect but didn't know the cause. And then science comes around and shows the cause. And all of a sudden, science says, we've just disproven God. You thought God was the cause. And the problem is that as Christians, we have missed the boat. If we don't understand God is the cause of not only what we know, but what we don't know, he's the cause of both. He's the cause of all of it. So you can say, how did Mark get here? And the answer might be from the union of a father's sperm with a mother's ovum. But it's really so much more than that. that there is a God who set into motion this whole idea that a sperm could union with an ova. That there's a, and science is really good at explaining the how. But the why is where it falls woefully short. There are some splendid writers on this. A fellow named John Polkinghorne, a physicist out of England, who was in their National Academy of Sciences equivalent over there, top-notch physicist. After leaving the Academy of Physics, became an Anglican priest and has written a bunch on this. Others, Alistair McGrath and others, who are fully marvelous in the science world and yet firm in their belief. And so I think that sometimes we get too balled up into trying to assign to God an immediate scientific cause to things. And then when science gives the real cause, people are left they just lost their argument for God and look kind of foolish. And I say God is the cause of things we don't know, but he's also the cause of things we know. He's the ultimate cause of everything. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, how he goes about doing all of his stuff, I don't know. He's God. But he's given us science. He's given us an ability. See, in my opinion, when I look at science and the wonders of it, I'm amazed that God would have thought of all this stuff. It blows me away. And the more I understand the intricacies of it, the more I get so, my buddy, Seattle Vic, when we're sitting there having that session, you know what, the seminar that I started out with, he says, Mark, just leave behind your Christianity. Come, feel the warm embrace of agnosticism. Leave where you are and come to me. And I looked at him, I said, Vic, I got to tell you, I just don't have enough faith. I said, what? I said, it takes more faith not to believe in God than it does to believe in God. Man, I'm sorry, I just can't put all this stuff down to chance. I mean, if I thought chance was this easy, I'd be buying lottery tickets all the time. I mean, the lottery's like a gimme compared to what all's had to happen for this to work. All
right. Some fantastic questions, including a very important question about your mom. How's your mom?
Mom's good, thank you. Mom is home at my daughter's basketball game right now in Houston, and Mom sends her love, and I should have brought Mom, and she'll be probably upset with me when she finds out I'm here.
Mark comes from good stock, the great Carolyn Lanier. We're so thankful for her contributions to the community of Lubbock.
Yeah, thank you.
Interesting question here. We've got some of our college students here, Mark. Interesting question about millennials. We were talking about this earlier. What's your assessment of the status of faith and the potential for millennials?
Okay, millennials, here's my lesson for the millennial world. I love the way millennials think. And you can't categorize people. I mean, if people, who knows? But based on the books and a few millennials I deal with, I love the way they think. Because millennials are quick to hold on to a story. I think millennials should be reading C.S. Lewis like crazy. Mm. Not just his theology, but read his stories. Read his space trilogy. Read his Chronicles of Narnia. Mm. Because I love, you go to The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. That's the book that talks about where it was always winter but never Christmas. And there are two stories. And this is the way a lot of millennials think. There are two stories, and you get to pick which reality. And the kids are faced with this in that book. Which reality are they going to accept as true? Is this a frigid winter land run by this witch who is a good woman trying to do the best she can with what she's got? She'll give you Turkish delights if she's pleased with you. Or, as absurd as it may sound, is this a broken land that she has usurped? And it's actually a land that was meant to be fairer and more magnificent, ruled by Aslan, who is a fearsome lion, but a loving lion. You know, to think in the dynamic of story, what reality are you going to buy? Are you going to buy that we're all a bunch of happenstance chances? I got to tell you, this Actos case I tried earlier this year, one of the issues that was involved, Actos is a diabetes drug, and it's an insulin sensitizer. So it goes into a cell, and when you get into the cell, you're just in the cytosol, you're in the plasma around the cell. The real brain tank of the cell is the nucleus. That's got the DNA. You can get into the cell, but man, it takes a card-carrying privilege to get into the nucleus, to be transnucleic. And there are these little bitty, I call them the ambassadors. They're peroxisome proliferated activated receptors, PPARs, that exist in the cytosol, and they're like ambassadors. They have the key to get into the nucleus, and they have a plus one card, so they can take something with them. And they take the Actos molecule and say, come on in, I'll get you into the nucleus. You can go in there and tickle the DNA where you want to. Turns out we don't just have one kind of PPAR. We got PPAR alphas, we got PPAR gammas, we got PPAR deltas that go tickle different parts of the DNA. This just happened? And it just happened? In trillions of cells and beings, and it's not just in humans. So somewhere in the billions of strands of genetic code that we have, there was just happened to be an activated section of code that happened to cause your body to grow little PPARs that are so small you can't see them in a microscope. They have to figure out they're there through logical deduction. And come on. Which story are you going to believe? That just happens and there's no wisdom anywhere behind it? There's nobody setting the knobs of the machine? That this whole thing, I mean, you tweak the knobs even a little bit and poof, we're gone. Gravity's gone. You tweak the knob of gravity a little bit. I mean, I like millennials thinking because they're willing to look at this stuff and say, I don't buy that. I don't care who's saying it. Because I don't buy that. I'm sorry. And it's not that I got to tell you, I'd buy it if I could believe it. I really would. I'm not like, I've made up my mind. I don't care what the reason is. No, man, I'm into reason. If it makes sense, I'll buy it. I'll change my mind tomorrow. But I can't find it. It doesn't make sense to me. I just don't buy it. I don't. I make a living out of selling stories. I can't sell that one.
There was, have you followed the news about this book that came out recently, The Lost Gospel,
reappropriating this text?
So we got a question here about your view of Gnostic texts.
Okay, well, Gnostic texts were real popular in the 200 era, 200, 300, 400 AD. Gnosticism was already moving as a movement early in the 90s, and you can see roots of it in the writings of 1 John, for example. Gnosticism comes from the Greek word gnosis, which means knowledge, and it was this idea that there is some secret knowledge that people don't really know about unless you're in the club. It's kind of like the secret handshake, and you can get in the club and you can learn these secret things. And part of that idea infiltrated Christianity, and it carried with it a very, what we would call now a Platonic concept, that things that you touch and feel and sense, the physical matter, that's evil, or at least inferior, that the really important things are the things you can know. Gnostics, the Greek word gnosis, we get knowledge from it. That's why we have the K in that word. Okay? So the Gnostics who know these things are existing on a higher level. So as they infiltrated the Christian faith, they would say things like, one big branch of it said, you know, Jesus was a man, and then when the Holy Spirit descended as a dove at his baptism, that was the Spirit, the greater, the good, the not, coming in. And then when Jesus was crucified, the Spirit left and watched the crucifixion from another hill. Because, you know, this just this separation of spirit and body. And the body's evil. Then there's another group that said, no, 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 Jesus was an apparition. When he walked along the sands of the seashore, he left no feet print. And it's in response to some of this that the apostle, that we read 1 John where he writes and he says, look, we saw him, we touched him, we felt him. Because that's what he's addressing. So out of this Gnostic movement come these writings that fictionalize Jesus. And this new gospel that talks about Jesus and Mary having two kids, that's not a new gospel. And it wasn't just found in the dusty archives. That's been written on for decades and decades. This new guy's just peddling the book to get sales. Even the scholars who aren't believing Christians say, there's nothing new about this. This book's been around for decades. Everybody's already written on it. Scholastic articles on it. And it's a bunch of fol-de-rol, and this comes around about every 3 or 4 years, and someone else will sell a bunch of stuff off of it. And it's the writings from someone 300 or 400 years after Jesus trying to explain stuff that's got no basis in reality. Let me put it to you this way. It's as close to Jesus in time as we are to events that happened in the 15, 1600s. I mean, it's a long stinking time later.
One more question. I want to ask you about the tone of conversations that we have with non-believers. One of the things I appreciate about the book, Mark, and the way that you've...
the book, Mark, that's good.
Oh, that was good. How about that? Is the tone you take. You use humor, and, you know, so often today, I think we talk past each other when people we disagree with, and particularly about things
that are
sensitive.
No, I'm sorry, please go ahead. No.
Things as sensitive as religion. So how do we engage, you do this a lot, how do we engage those who don't agree with us, not just talking about what we say, but how we say it and how we try to connect with folks who may not see things our way?
Well, that's a really interesting question, and that's a chore. So here are my fundamentals that I try to let be my guiding principle in this. I want to show people love. I want them to see in my treatment, in the respect, in the honor that I show them, that I love them. Because that's who God is. I want people to understand that sometimes that takes the shape. I've got a lot of people who work with me who are atheists and agnostics, and I talk to them a lot. It's kind of hard because I'm their boss. You know, you don't want to sit there and say, you'd have a better future in my law firm if you'd be a believing Christian. You know, I mean, where does that get us? But what I do want them to know is, hey, man, I know you land at a whole different place than I do on this, and I'm really interested in that. How can two people who are pretty, you know, much thinkers, who think for a living, how can we come to this biggest issue of life and be on such opposite ends of the answer? So just help me understand you. And I'm not out to bludgeon someone, and I'm not out to win a debate, and I'm not out to win an argument. It takes God to convert people. So it's my goal is not to convert them. But blessed are the feet of those who carry the good news. And I want to be, as Paul said, I want to be all things to all people. So I want to try and relate to them. I want to show them honor. But I also want to be a light on a hillside and let them know that, you know, this is interesting to me. I don't understand why you don't believe. And you know, have you thought about this? And how do you handle that? And if I hit catch a frigid moment, and hit a rough spot, I back away. And sometimes I'm quick to say, I didn't mean to offend you. You know, please understand, I don't mean to offend you at all. I'm just really curious about this. And try to keep a very obvious loving spirit. And not a fake one, but one where you genuinely care for them. Mm. And so I've got a list of people that I pray for to know the Lord. And I try to pray for them every morning and every night. And just the very act of praying for these people by name makes me, I hope and I believe, more sensitive to trying to be someone who loves them and is able to be the voice that shares with them in the right way. So I think it's love. I think it's patience. I think it's kindness. I think it's gentleness. I think it's empathy. But I think it's still conversation and direction in the right times, in the right place. And overriding all of it, prayer.
Mm. Our mutual friend Ken Starr was right here a couple years ago, and he said that the word he used was winsome, that approaching non-believers, it's an old-fashioned word.
I love the word winsome.
I love that word. I think that's a great...
And that's how we want to be.
Yeah.
We need to try to be winsome.
Yeah, it's good.
It's a great word.
Will you join me in showing appreciation for Mark Lanier?
Thank you. Thank you, brother.
This has been a great evening. You've been a great audience. You've given great questions. And I think I was accurate in telling you that you made the right choice to come out this evening. It's been excellent to share this information and to be challenged like we have been. Mark, out of respect for you, I'm going to ask Terry Creech to come up. He is one of the trustees for our university. And I'm going to ask him to lead a prayer of blessing for you. I see him. I looked in the wrong spot.
Would you pray with me, please? Father, we come before you tonight. We thank you for this evening. We thank you, Father, for the work that Mark is doing on your behalf. Father, I thank you for the time that he has put into this book. I thank for the time that he has put in being an ambassador for you, both in Lubbock and Houston and in parts all around the world. Father, I ask that you continue to be with him, that you, Father, guard his heart, protect it from attacks of the evil one. Father, may it always be filled with love for you, love for his fellow man, and love for himself. Father, I ask that you be with his soul. May it continue, Father, to yearn for you and long for home. Father, please be with his mind. Please continue to keep it sharp. Please continue to keep it creative. And may he use, Father, that creativity to be an ambassador for you in unique and special ways here on this earth. And Father, please give him the strength for the journey to do the good works that you prepared for him to do. Help us, Father, to always, all of us, be ambassadors for you and all that we say and do and everywhere we go. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. We're going to excuse our two...